Hello and welcome to Beacon Hill Update on Frontier Community Access Television. I'm your host, Chris Collins. My guest today is Franklin County Sheriff Chris Donelan. Before we get to the sheriff and talk about all things happening in the world of corrections, this is the first taping we've done since the announcement that the Kinder Morgan Company was suspending work on the proposed $3.3 billion natural gas pipeline. We've done a lot of coverage of this issue on these channels. And the local media, of course, has been all over the story. I don't think anybody expected Kinder Morgan would take their ball and go home that quickly, but I'm sure there are a lot of people out there that are still celebrating, and why not? I mean, the environmental damage this project could have caused to some very sensitive land, astronomical, and it was good to see people stand up and be counted. And I think that there are people that feel like the resistance that was put up in Western Mass was the primary reason why the project got beat. I don't think it was the primary reason, but it certainly had a lot to do with it. And Article 97 and the protections that are contained within also helped. But I want to caution people. I mean, I know people are very excited about this, and they should be. It's a big victory. But it doesn't change the inherent issue, which is that there is an inadequate supply of natural gas in this area. And I don't see any of the gas companies, Columbia or Berkshire Gas, getting rid of that moratorium anytime soon. So we cheer the defeat of this project. I do, as well as everybody else does. Anybody who cares about this area should. But recognize the problem has not gone away with the defeat of that project. And I think we have to keep that in mind. And also keep in mind that just as quickly as this project arrived, it could come back if market conditions change. The fundamental reason why Kinder Morgan walked away was because they weren't going to make enough profit. 6% was not enough of a profit margin for them to be able to justify going forward with a project that would not have been paid for by taxpayers through tariffs. So, we live to fight another day. The pipeline is dead for now, but keep in mind, it could come back, and we'll be keeping an eye closely on any developments toward that end. One guy who doesn't have to worry about any of that stuff anymore is Chris Donelan. He is the sheriff of Franklin County, running for re-election. How fast 6 years go by.
It's amazing, isn't it?
You serve four terms in the House before you became the sheriff. I'm sure you're very happy not to have to have this on your plate.
Yeah, two-year terms are a thing of the past for me. Hope to never revisit them.
But you had said that the 6 years that you were in this office went by pretty fast. Yeah. What have you learned in 6 years as a sheriff?
I'm just amazed at how much I didn't know when I really started this job. Dealing with the people, the different aspects of the office of sheriff, whether it's running the House of Correction, or working with the police chiefs. We have so many irons in the fire. But I look back, I've learned a lot, made a lot of changes, and it's really been a gratifying and productive first term.
It couldn't have been easy, because the guy before you was there for 18 years. Yeah. And there were people that had been there for a lot of that time, and I'm sure that they were used to the way Fred McDonald did business. And you know, here's this new guy coming in, Chris Donelan, and young guy who we know, but we don't really know. And I know my understanding is House of Corrections, you know, they close ranks, and it's a very tight-knit operation. Mm. How are you able to overcome some of the obstacles you came in contact with?
Well, first of all, I think clearly knowing I was going to be there for 6 years, 6 years is an eternity when you're in the first year, right? And right. So when I'm proposing changes and these people are looking at, wow, this guy's going to be around for a while, so we can either exhaust ourselves fighting everything he wants to do, or we can give it a try and see how it's going to turn out. We also had a lot of turnover. Those first few years, when I arrived, the first thing I did was have a staff meeting with the executive staff. And I basically told them that things are going to change. You're all welcome to be part of the team. If you want to climb on board with what we're doing, welcome aboard. If you don't, we're going to have problems. And we had some people retire because they didn't want to invest in it. Some people we pushed towards retirement. But we were patient about it. Patient about how we dealt with them, patient about their attitudes, patient about how we tried to change the direction of the agency, and I think that patience paid off.
It's different. I mean, it all comes back to politics, but it's different when you're the boss as opposed to being one of 140 representatives. Is that the main difference between the two jobs? I mean, the House of Corrections itself is a huge operation. It's a political organization, but it's also sort of an island unto itself. Yeah. You know, is it tough to get used to being in charge of that island?
It was an adjustment. Before, I would bring ideas and people to the table, and then I'd walk away and move on to the next project. So the most gratifying piece of it is being able to see projects through from beginning to end, because I'm not going anywhere. The problems aren't going anywhere, and we have to address them, and we have to make adjustments as we're addressing them, and then see them through to fruition. So that was probably the biggest change in what I was used to as a state representative.
I want to talk about your approach to this job a little bit in depth, because you know, a lot of people look at a House of Corrections and they think crime and punishment. They think, put away the bad guys, keep them down until you leave them. But you have come at this from a whole different perspective. It seems like you're focused more on what happens when they get out than what happens when they're actually in stir. Talk about that a little bit. I mean, your feeling is that you have to work with these people. A lot of them are kids, they're involved in drugs, while they're there, so they can be ready to be good people when they get out.
Yeah. These are our neighbors. I said when I ran for sheriff, nobody serves a life sentence at the House of Correction. So every one of these guys is coming back to the community, and they're from our community. So they're not going anywhere. The question is, what condition do we want them in when they return to our neighborhoods? And so that's the angle we've taken here. And, you know, the bottom line is, if they're sober and if they're employed and if they're able to pay their rent and they're able to support their kids and they're not committing new crimes, we've all won. So I think that some people kind of look at some of my ideas, particularly those who slant towards the Republican angle, as I'm being a little bit crazy liberal. But one of the things even Washington Democrats and Republicans agree on is we want to reduce crime, we want to reduce recidivism, we want to spend less money on jails and prisons and more money on things like schools and infrastructure. There's only one way to do it, and that's to get at the root causes of why these guys are committing their crimes and get them to stop doing it.
Speaking of recidivism, you spoke at a conference in D.C. in November on this topic, and I guess bottom line for me, what your message was when you went there.
Well, we were called in because we got a two-year federal grant on our programs and reentry, and they saw what we were doing as very successful, and they wanted us to present to other counties across the country that are trying to come up with great recidivism programs. And the lion's share of what they were trying to draw from us is the best practice treatment program that we're providing, which is a dual diagnosis, trauma-informed treatment program. And then the work we do partnering with the community and what we call the soft handoff. So when someone leaves the House of Correction and returns to the community, it's not a shock to their system. I mean, think about it. These guys have had every decision made for them for 6 months, 12 months, some guys for 2 years. It's quite a dramatic change to all of a sudden be free to do whatever you want to do. So we try to temper that adjustment, going from medium security to minimum security. We have a treatment program where these guys are engaged in a community-wide meeting every day, which is similar to an AA meeting that they would go to, so that they learn how to behave and speak appropriately in these meetings. Gradually going towards community service work, and then to our reentry house where they have more freedoms. They prepare their own meals. They have a living room that they share in common. They have bedrooms instead of cells. From there, they start getting jobs. We take them to their work. We have people who have donated bicycles, so in the good weather, these guys are riding bikes to work and then coming back to the facility. But they're getting jobs. They're understanding how to deal with an employer, how to do a resume, how to do an interview, how to deal with customers, these kinds of things. And that kind of soft transition, and then the clinical people in the jail set them up with clinical providers in the community that they're going to continue to see. And this all, this gradual kind of soft handoff really helps to ensure that they'll be successful in their transition from the jail to the community and they won't come back.
How many prisoners have you seen come back? I mean, has it worked? Do you have any numbers? Has the recidivism rate dropped, I guess, as a result of these programs?
No, I've seen guys come back. Relapse is a part of recovery, and that's going to be, so recidivism to a degree is maybe part of the transition. But our recidivism rate was around 68% before we started. We had never tracked recidivism before. This is probably one of the shocks that I found when I became sheriff, is nobody in Massachusetts had tracked recidivism. So this program allows us to do that going forward. So we got a baseline for recidivism, and now we're going to spend the next 4 to 5 years, because that's really the amount of time that it takes to see if somebody comes back, looking at our recidivism rate, watching for a 20 to 30% reduction in our recidivism rate, because that's what this program targets for. But the big difference between this program and a lot of others is that we go after every inmate, including the most difficult ones. A lot of houses of correction only offer programs, jobs, and vocational training to the easy guys. We go after everybody because it's the difficult inmates, it's the most hardened ones that commit the most crimes. So if you turn them around, you're having a greater impact on public safety and on crime rates in the community.
Take me through how it works. Let's suspend disbelief, and we're really going to have to suspend it for this exercise. Say I'm a 22-year-old, all right, who's just convicted of a B&E. I get hit with a two-year sentence. I'm obviously on drugs. I come to your door. What's the first? How does it work? What's the first thing that happens?
The first thing you do is sit down and have a risk need assessment with a counselor, and they go over your criminal history. I mean, these are some things that can't change, right?
Sure.
You got a criminal record; it's 4 pages long. That doesn't change. We have that statistic. Your history of substance use; it's documented. It's there. That doesn't change. Family problems, social problems. Who do you hang out with? Are your parents divorced? These kinds of things are all part of your risk need assessment. So then we. Basically, it's like sitting down with a college counselor, right? Here's all your issues, and here's all the classes that we offer to address those issues. You can sign up for all these things and move to the treatment unit, or you can go sit in that cell for 2 years.
Yeah, so they're given a choice, basically. Yes. You can either, you know, take what we're offering you, or do, I guess, what could be classified as harder time.
Yeah. It is harder time. You're in lockdown more often. You spend more time sitting in your cell. We can't order somebody into treatment, but what we can do is make sure that you get no privileges. Yeah.
Yeah.
The treatment unit offers television. It offers outdoor yard. It offers a cookie once in a while after dinner. It offers much more free time outside of your cell. I mean, these are things, work jobs inside the facility. These are things that an inmate population treasures. And you get none of those things if you don't go to the treatment unit. So it's a carrot stick approach. Grab the carrot. And we have over 80% of our guys grabbing the carrot and going to our treatment unit.
So as I'm in STIR for 2 years and I'm in the treatment facility and the treatment unit, is there a setup where I have a structured schedule? In other words, do you teach these inmates how to live a structured daily schedule?
Yeah.
Pretty much?
They're up at the crack of dawn. They have breakfast together. They have a morning meeting. And once morning meeting is over, they have a mindfulness session, which is really incredible to watch 70 guys sit quietly and have a mindfulness session for 30 minutes. It was a little bit rocky at first.
Now, what is it? What is a mindfulness session?
Mindfulness session is basically you sit for 30 minutes, a clinician runs it, and you close your eyes, and they pick a different journey every day. You know, one time it might be to the ocean. One time each person might pick their own particular happy place. It was a baseball field. Or, you know, if you played football, it might be football practice. It could be a beach. It could be a mountain. But you put yourself there. And then you sit and you start your day. And they talk about, you know, what you're going to be doing. It's about breathing exercises. It's about reducing stress.
It's like a meditation kind of a thing?
Yeah. Pretty much, yeah.
Interesting.
And so that's how they start their day. And then the class structure starts. We have classes scheduled all day. And you look at your schedule. All right now I've got a Thinking for Change meeting. So the guys line up and head to class. Thinking for Change, that we have other exercises like putting distance between something that happens and your reaction to it, because this is what typically gets guys arrested, right? Something happens in their house, in their neighborhood, and instead of thinking about it and thinking about how they're going to react to it, they just react spontaneously, and more often than not, it gets them arrested. So we teach them tools to put some space between what happened and how you react to it.
It's interesting. It sounds very new agey. It does not sound like something you would expect in a quote unquote prison environment.
Historically, it's been, we're going to have a class on alcohol and how evil it is. We're going to have a class on marijuana. We're going to have a class on why you shouldn't do these things to your body and the impact that it has on your body. And we're going to have some AA meetings. And that's typically, I think, what you would expect in a house of correction.
Right.
We're trying to drill down at the underlying issues that lead people to alcohol, that lead people to drugs. And it could be trauma, it could be a mental health issue. Whatever it is, we try to identify it in each person and try to drill it down. And what is it about your insecurity, your history, your issue that makes you feel like you can't enter a room and interact with people without being high?
And that's what is at the heart of addiction.
Yeah.
To a person, and Ruth Poteel will tell you this, she's told me this, I've seen her make presentations, and we'll talk about Ruth and the task force in a second, is that people think it's just about getting them to kick, but what makes them grab the needle in the first place?
Yeah.
That's the part that never really gets dealt with.
Yeah, if you're abused at 2 years old, at kindergarten, at first grade, whenever it happened in your childhood, if there was a childhood trauma that hit you, as an adult, you may not even be able to specifically identify the event, but the trauma is there. And without dealing with that issue, that feeling, that insecurity, you can be sober for 6 months while you're in jail and get out, and you're going to use. There's no doubt about it. You're going to use.
Your other fellow sheriffs, around the Commonwealth. I'm curious how they react when you tell them about programs like that. Do they think you're nuts? Do they think you're wasting your time? Do they think this is just going too much? It's too much effort? Or do you think that people are realizing this is a system that works?
I think when we start to show evidence, right now, most of the sheriffs do programs, and most of them will tell you their program is the best. So they really don't have a lot of interest in learning about mine. When we start to show success, the open-minded guys will say, yeah, there may be some validity to this, and they'll start making adjustments to their programs, and I'm confident that we're going to see the success. The one thing that I do that they look at me like I'm crazy is the medically assisted treatment we offer at the jail. We're the first house of correction in the country to do it this way, and that is basically if somebody comes into our jail with a prescription, under a doctor's care, appropriately using a substance like Suboxone, we will continue that treatment for them while they're in the house of correction.
So the conventional wisdom is to just take them off of the cold turkey?
Take them off of it. And I sat back and I said to myself, we're talking about addiction as a disease. And if we're going to be consistent about that, when we do a medical evaluation of an inmate who comes in and they have diabetes, we continue their diabetes medication.
Exactly.
Yet we yank them off their medically assisted treatment. That's not consistent. So we're doing that now. And no other facility, no other house of correction does that. There's two prisons, one in Colorado and Rikers Island in New York does it. So this allows them to be stable, to participate intelligently, and to gain from our treatment program if they're stable on their Suboxone. On the other side, the pretrial population. So we have somebody who's on probation. They're in the Suboxone treatment program. They violate their probation. It might be a fine due. They go to jail for a week to wait to see the judge. We yank them off their Suboxone. What do you think happens to them?
They go nuts.
They become a drug-seeking missile.
Yeah.
And the minute we release them from the House of Correction, they're out jamming needles into their arms at the level that they were using before, and that's when you overdose and die. And that's the whole Narcan issue. And you know. And so why would we do that to somebody when a simple strip of Suboxone will keep them stable and keep them on their treatment program?
You know, when you talk about this, it really, that to me is the real difference in the drug discussion now, especially with Governor Baker. I mean, it seems like the state's finally realizing that you have to treat this as a medical condition, yeah, not just as a crime and punishment issue. And you know, the example of diabetes is a great one, because if you brought an inmate in and you took their insulin away, not only would that be crazy, but the person could die and you would be, yeah, criminally liable.
Yeah.
But yet they have no problem yanking Suboxone and methadone and other things that are keeping these guys at least not to the point where they're jamming needles, like I said, they're on 24/7.
The bottom line is everybody's addiction is different and everybody's treatment program is going to be different. It's individualized. So it would be crazy to give some of these guys Suboxone. And in those cases, we won't do it. But in some cases, it's what that patient needs because that's where they are in their recovery. And that's just the way that it is. So we try to adjust our program so that we meet the individual needs of their treatment needs, but also their individual medical needs.
The drug thing is, it's so pervasive, and it really is hitting families really, really hard. I know you have kids coming in, not kids, but men coming into your facility who are fathers. Talk to me about the Better Fathers Initiative. What is that all about?
We have a program, we have two programs. One is a fatherhood program in partnership with the North Quabbin Community Coalition, and they come in and they do a very basic program about how to be a good dad. A piece of that is every holiday season, we have folks who come in. One of them is the children's librarian at the Greenfield Library. Mm-hmm. They come in and they videotape the guys reading books to their kids, and we mail it home to the kids.
Nice.
So the dad's reading a Christmas story at the holiday time. So that's very nice. We have another more comprehensive program where they really sit down with these guys and teach them not only about how to be a good dad, but how to deal with problem children. Because more often than not, their children are a problem. And they might be a problem because there was alcohol or drugs used during the pregnancy. They might be a problem because they have trauma of their own, seeing mom and dad get drunk and beat each other up. They've got trauma because dad going to jail is trauma.
Sure.
So they have to learn how to deal with this and how to cope with it and how to try to stop the cycle. And, you know, it was amazing. The guys do evaluations on the programs at the end. And two of the evaluations that stick out in my head is one of the guys said, I wish my father had had this program, which means he probably went through a pretty tough growing up himself. And the other one was the dad who said, I had no idea that getting arrested in front of my son and being sentenced to jail had any impact on him. That almost knocked me out of my chair.
Yeah.
Because an ordinary person like you or me, it's obvious that kind of a situation would traumatize our children. But he never thought twice about it because he was never taught himself. And so he basically sat back and said, I'm never coming to jail again because I'm never doing that to my son again. So for me, that's one as far as improving our recidivism rate, because I believe him. I believe he'll never come back because he won't want to do that to his son.
When you're in that kind of a haze of addiction, whatever the drug, alcohol, you know, whatever, it's impossible to look at life rationally. Yeah. And imagine if you're a kid and you're seeing, you know, your support system, your parent, can't see life rationally, that kid's not going to get a very good start in life.
Yeah.
So it's important to build those skills when you have in front of you. I think that's an amazing part that I wasn't even aware of until I looked up some of the stuff you've been working on. And I think that's so elemental. Let's talk about the drug issue for a second. You're one of the founding members of the Franklin County Opioid Task Force. You, John Merrigan, Dave Sullivan, and Stan Rosenberg was involved.
Ruth
Brote. And you're doing a lot of work. Ruth is working in your facility all the time. And what was shocking to me when we were talking about building this new treatment facility in Greenfield was, up until that facility opens, the only way you could have an inpatient drug treatment session was to go to jail, to go to the House of Corrections. That blows my mind. I can't believe that that's been allowed to exist as long as it has. So I guess your reaction to that, and how has the task force improved the lot in life for a lot of these guys?
Well, unfortunately, still the only way to get the evidence-based long-term treatment in probably Massachusetts is to go to the Franklin County House of Correction, because our infrastructure for treatment in Massachusetts is geared towards alcoholics. It hasn't made the transition yet away from the 7-day detox, the 14-day treatment program, and then outpatient counseling and AA meetings. That's the way the whole system is geared. And we're trying to move away from that. We're trying to get to a program more of a 90-day initial treatment and then sober living, up to a year sober living environment, to have an impact on this opioid issue. So we still have to get there. But what we're doing in Franklin County, we couldn't have done without Stan and Steve.
Right.
We were a bunch of well-intentioned volunteers trying to grapple or get our arms around a problem that we were seeing explode in front of our faces. But it was all good intentions and very little result until Stan and Steve came through with an earmark in the state budget for us that allowed us to hire an executive director to try to kind of navigate all the great ideas and all the great people that wanted to become involved. So the task force basically became the catalyst of lots of working groups and subcommittees that came up with great things like the prescriber pledge. So we were the first in the Commonwealth to have doctors voluntarily sign on to limit pain pills that they were prescribing. So we got to some of these core things that the governor's opioid task force codified in law, but those things started on a voluntary basis here in Franklin County. So we've had a significant impact here locally, but we've also had an impact across the Commonwealth.
And in terms of Ruth's role, Ruth Protea's role, what does she do for you? She comes in and she teaches classes. What is her role?
Well, she chairs the healthcare subcommittee, which really gets to the emergency rooms and how the emergency rooms deal with addicts and overdoses when they come in. That's a huge piece. People were going into emergency rooms overdosed. They would watch them and stabilize them, and as soon as they were sober enough to get up and walk out, they were gone.
Yeah.
Nothing was happening. We now have counselors available to the emergency rooms to work with the families, to work with these people, to try to connect them to treatment. So hopefully they don't walk out of the emergency room. They go somewhere for treatment. And that's a huge difference. I mean, it sounds trivial, but it's a huge difference from what we were doing before. She's also doing the physiology of addiction lecture across the country.
That's fascinating.
Changing people's perception of addicts and how they deal with their addiction. And that's been a big piece of it.
One of the obstacles, I think, to an inpatient program has been that insurance companies won't only cover a certain number of days, right?
Yeah.
In other states, they'll cover up to 90 days, but here in Massachusetts, it's like, 16 or?
But even what they say they'll cover, they say they'll cover 30. But once you get into treatment, all of a sudden, you know, your son or daughter's home in 10 days. What are you doing here? Well, you got 30 days. Well, that's the insurance company decided that I was ready to go home. and that's the end of it. So it's very frustrating.
Before we let you go, I got to ask you about the animal shelter update. The sheriff's department has been operating an animal shelter in Turner's Falls, and we're going to be going into a new facility because the one you're in now is going to go away because of an access road for an industrial park. Where are we on that project? And you know, animals are close to all of our hearts here at FCAT especially. Where are you on that?
We have identified a parcel of land that we're going to be leasing from the town of Montague right next to the public safety complex. We have an organization called the Friends of the Kennel, which is going to be fundraising for us to do that. And the facility will actually be under their control. I shouldn't say this on TV, but we're trying to do this to stay away from DCAM.
Nobody in Boston listened to that last 15 seconds. Right.
So we're moving forward with it. We hope to have an agreement signed, a lease agreement signed with the town of Montague soon. We'd be able to get in there with an engineer and start plotting out where we're going to put it, start clearing the lot. The biggest challenge is going to be fundraising.
Always
so if
is.
Folks out there, you know, if you love animals and you want to have a huge impact on animals in Franklin County, look up the Friends of the Kennel and make a contribution towards this new kennel. We've saved over 600 dogs in the last 2 years. Our rate of adoption or reuniting with families is over 94%. So we're doing wonderful, wonderful work there.
And this is another example of an organization. I mean, you know, Dakin does the best they can. O'Connor does. That's where I got my dog, O'Connor, in Springfield. But in Franklin County, there hasn't been any facility like this until, you know, the Sheriff's Department took it on.
And it came from the police chiefs. And when I became sheriff, I said, tell me what I can do quickly to impact your lives. And they said, all of these towns have lost their animal control or dog officers. Yeah. We take all these calls. We end up with a stray dog in the backseat of our cruiser, and the dog's on patrol with us because we have nowhere to leave it. Could you help us with that? And that's how this started, and it's just really blossomed from there.
So you're running for re-election.
Yes.
I have a hard time believing, Sheriff, you're going to have an opponent. I mean, I know you never want to say that. No politician ever wants to say, I'm running unopposed, but I don't know. I suppose this way. I haven't heard of anybody even contemplating challenging you. So you're probably going to have an unopposed run, but you don't ever run any campaign like that, right? You always assume that you're going to have an opponent.
Well, I assume I'm going to have an opponent, and I live every year of my term in the community talking with people. Because the more work you do between elections, the easier the re-elections are.
Exactly.
You know, and I think people have probably had enough with elections with this presidential primary. So one less debate for the office of sheriff, I'm sure all my constituents would appreciate.
Doesn't do anything for my viewers, because I mean, we always love to have a debate. But moving forward, you know, you're looking at the next 2 or 3 years, you're going to be analyzing more ways to improve the corrections operation. Any ideas early going what that will look like? What ideas are you looking at to change?
Yeah, I mean, I would like to move more towards long-term sober housing, which impacts both my population and the community. We need to build up more our community support and post-release support, so that's going to be a focus that we have for the next couple of years. And I want to expand in my second term the collaborations with the communities. The first few years, there were a lot of people who accused me of trying to become the police chief of Franklin County. Yeah. So a lot of people kept me at arm's length when I tried to collaborate. I think over the last 5 or so years, I've shown people that I have no interest in growing the job. I get paid the same whether I'm the sheriff of Franklin County or whether I take over other things, and I have really no interest in doing that. I just want to be a good partner so that we're all providing effective services for our community and enhancing public safety. So I think we're going to see increased collaboration outside with public safety partners over the second term.
Well, I think that you certainly have a lot of good things going on there, and I've even learned more about the operation just talking to you in this last half hour. And if anybody wants to find out more, where's the best place to get information on what's going on in your facility?
The website. We have a website that's which we try to keep up. We're pretty busy, but we try to keep it up, which explains each of our divisions and what we do. But feel free to stop in. I mean, we have people from the community. We have volunteers. We're always looking for more volunteers to come in and help, but we're happy to show folks around.
You're doing a lot of good work. I appreciate you making the time to come in. I'll let you get back to business. My guest has been Franklin County Sheriff Chris Donelan. I'm Chris Collins. That's Beacon Hill Update. Thanks for watching. For all of us here at FCAT, have a good day.